Great to see you this morning. Great to see your exuberance and excitement. Glad you brought that with you today to worship. We're going to channel that, right? Channel it to worship this morning. Just a couple of announcements this morning. If you have a need or a prayer request, make sure and tear that little insert off from the bulletin, and you can leave that in the offering plate as you leave today. We would love to pray for you. Of course, want to mention to those who are watching online, welcome. We're so glad you're here today, and we're so glad we can worship with you as well, and cannot wait to see you here. This morning, we are excited to have Dan Conway, the masked man in purple here. Dan is our candidate for youth minister here at Southwest, and so we're really pumped to have him with us today. And we're going to be having after church, immediately following, according to our bylaws here at Southwest, we're going to have a vote of affirmation just to agree with our eldership that he is the right man for the job. And so we've been praying about him for him. We're so just glad that you're here, and I look forward to where God's going to take us together as a church in the future and how we can serve the Lord together.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand together this morning. And we're going to do that immediately following the worship service today. So we'll give you some more details on that after we are finished with worship today. As we turn our attention to the Lord this morning, I want to read a scripture to you from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10. Jesus says, "Do not be afraid of those who oppose you and persecute you. There is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from the will of your Father. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth far more than many sparrows. Whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before men, I will disown him before my Father in heaven." Church, let's be sure and acknowledge the Lord as we seek him today. Let's acknowledge him as our Lord, as our Savior, and certainly, as Jesus has said, as the one who knows the very hairs on our head, who knows the thoughts of our heart, and who cares about us. He is worthy of our worship. Let's pray together. Father, as David cried out, "What is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him?" But Father, you do care. Father, you did not spare your one and only son for us. So Father, we can trust that you have our best interest in mind. Father, we know that you will then give us everything that we need for life and faith in this life, and that we can put our hope in you and our trust in you for eternal life because of who you are. You are a good and faithful, gracious and loving God whose loving kindness and whose faithfulness continues for generation after generation after generation, Father, as a God whose will and work is accomplished all around the globe, that your word is going forth, that your gospel is being preached, that lives are being changed. And Father, so our hope is in you. And just move among us this morning. Stir us up as we seek you in your word, as we seek you in prayer. Father, move us to love one another well. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's go ahead and praise our Lord. He is worthy of all glory and honor. Amen.
Amen. We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you.
Lord, you are.
go before the Lord in prayer. Dear Father in heaven, holy, holy is your name. There's none like you. There's no one even close, Lord. Lord, we come this morning to bring you glory and honor, to receive your word to our lives that it might change us, Lord, that it might affect us, that it might move us in your will, Lord, that we might bear fruit for you, to bring those who are far away near, and to lift up those who are near, to encourage them to stay on the path. Lord, we love you, and we love your word, and what it does for us and through us, Lord. We thank you for your son's precious gift that brought us hope. And it's in his name we pray. Jesus is our Savior. Amen. Amen. May you be seated.
As we turn our attention to the table this morning, you can have it at any place during the service. The beginning of worship, the end of worship, but as we come to the table in the middle of the service, in my mind, I envision it as a picture, as it is the centerpiece of what we're doing here. It's the center of the room the table is positioned, because it is the work of Christ on the cross that is the centerpiece of our salvation.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, it is the centerpiece of salvation history, splitting time from before Christ to the year of our Lord, to the time of the kingdom of heaven reigning on the earth. And so as we come to this time, it is a time of joy, because we are grateful for what Christ has done, but it is also a time of solemnness, a time of sobriety, a time of seriousness as we consider our own sins in light of Christ's perfection and our own desperate need, truly desperate need for what Christ has accomplished on the cross and our desperate need for Him. I want to share with you from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, this reminder that Paul left for us. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, He took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes.'" And until He comes again, church, we will be faithful in proclaiming that Christ crucified is why we are here. And it is all for His glory. Shall we pray? Father, I often think of what a simple reminder this is, humble reminder that nearly anyone, anywhere in the world can take part. Rather than being some magnificent building or some great statue, some shrine to go to or mountain to climb, Father, You have left us simply with these humble emblems that are accessible to those who are rich, to those who are poor, to those of every time period, Father. And that is because You are so accessible. Because You have come to us, Lord, and You have invited us to come to You, that whosoever desires may come. And so, Father, we come to You this morning, humble, grateful recipients of everything that You have done for us. And we will proclaim Christ crucified with our hearts, with our lips, with our lives. Because without it, we have no hope. But that the Lord of glory died for us and is risen again. And in that we rejoice. Thank You, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning once again. We're going to dismiss our kids for junior church this morning. Heading down with Miss Bobby. And it's going to be a great morning of learning and worship. And we're going to continue here as the big kids upstairs today. All right. Let's go ahead and pray this morning as we seek the Lord. Father in heaven, may the words of my mouth and the meditation that is in our hearts, Lord, may be pleasing, acceptable in your sight, Father. Lord, turn our attention to you. Father, we sing, we want to hear you, we say we want to hear you, but Father, give us ears to listen. May that truly be the desire of our hearts, to hear you speak and to know you more. To follow you more faithfully for your glory alone. In Christ's name, amen. We're in John chapter 19 this morning. If you have your Bibles, John 19. If you want to grab a Bible, one of the chairs, do that. Now, did you know that your body is about 60% water? Did you know that?
Yes.
It's about 60% water. So for instance, if you're a 150-pound person, you've got about 12 gallons of water in your body. That's pretty cool, isn't it? It's really, for me, just fascinating to think that. You know, you can't live without water, can you?
No.
You can't live without water. You need it. Dehydration leads to all sorts of terrible things. You get muscle cramps. You can get a headache. Some of you had that before? It's the number one cause of fatigue, isn't it? You just feel, if you don't have enough water, you feel worn out and tired. If you get dehydrated enough, you can land in a hospital even. You know, and they hook an IV up to you. So you'd rather drink it than have it, you know, pumping into your body. And your brain shuts down without water. So you need enough water. You know, you ever wake up and you just feel that tired feeling? Might be because you need to drink a little more water in your life. And they say you can even die if you don't drink enough water. So if you need to get up and get a drink, you're excused this morning. I don't know if I'll make it to the end of the service now. Water is essential to life, isn't it? Just drink your water, people. It's important. But this morning we're going to be in a passage that we skipped over. We're going to go back to the passage we looked at last week, but we skipped over the words of our Lord, the fifth statement of the cross, to look at the sixth statement last week. But we're going to go back to the fifth statement. Now the sixth statement is a statement that none of us can say. Just like Jesus said on the cross, he is the only one qualified, certified to say it is finished. But this is a statement that every single one of us can say because it resonates with all of us because we've all been thirsty, right? All of us have been thirsty and needed a drink at some time in our life. Now, in his dying moments, the thing that I want us to focus in on this morning is that we see Jesus' humanity on full display here on the cross. John chapter 19, follow along with me. It says, later, knowing that all was now completed, all finished, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. Now a jar full of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and they lifted it up to Jesus' lips. Now you might remember, it's a 6-hour scene on the cross, isn't it? From start to finish, Jesus is in agony hanging on the cross. And so you go back 6 hours previous to this, and if you remember, Jesus was offered a drink on the cross. Do you remember that? Now the drink was a little bit different. The Bible tells us in Mark chapter 15, the soldiers tried to give Jesus wine mixed with myrrh to drink, but he refused. That's 6 hours earlier. Now they're two different drinks, aren't they? If you're observing, you know that. Now we think of myrrh, what do we think of? We think of the wise men, don't we? They brought baby Jesus gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And generally that time of year when we hear a sermon on the gifts that the wise men brought, we think of, we're explained that myrrh had a very important use for embalming people. Remember that? And so when we think of the time when Jesus was born, it was a prophetic picture of this baby is born to die. His purpose is coming to die for the sins of the world. So there's a prophetic picture. But myrrh, as a matter of fact, had a number of uses. It was a very valuable commodity. And in this case, myrrh was used as a powerful narcotic. It was a painkiller. And so what they would do is they would take myrrh and they would mix it into wine or into a drink. And they would drink it and it would act to as a painkiller. To anesthetize. Well, at the crucifixion, the executioners offered Jesus wine mixed with myrrh as they crucified him. But in the initial drink, Jesus refused. Why is that? Because the wine mixed with myrrh would have done what to his senses? And it would have dulled his senses. And so Jesus refused to drink the wine that would dull his senses because he knew that he wanted to be clear-minded in accomplishing the will of his Father. He did not want to be anesthetized while he was bearing the weight and the burden of your sins and mine, the sins of the world on the cross. He wanted a crystal clear mind and clear thinking while he was on the cross. Now, the reason they would offer the wine mixed with myrrh is because crucifixion, as you know, as we've already discussed in this series, is a terrible, terrible, horrible process. Oftentimes in the crucifixion, the Roman soldiers would take those who were commissioned to do this, would take the person to be executed out to the crucifixion site. And they knew that this was going to be a long day because crucifixion was not only sometimes hours and hours and hours, but it could last days. And so they would come prepared with this wine mixed with myrrh because most of the time crucifixion involved someone hanging on a cross who was in constant torment and agony. So there would be moaning and groaning and even screaming that could last for hours. And so the Roman soldiers would then offer the wine mixed with myrrh in order to kind of numb the pain and just kind of put the person into a more, as most as he could be, a relaxed state. Because you can just imagine the mental suffering that it really would cause on the executioner to witness this and be in that situation. So now they offer Jesus this vinegary wine or this sour wine. Now why is that? Now, maybe it was out of duty. Maybe it was out of compassion. You know, I imagine that for a Roman soldier who's done this before on this detail, that when they were in this situation, Jesus on the cross, they're like, I've never seen a crucifixion like this before, right? Never witnessed anything like it. I've done 100 crucifixions, and I've never seen one like this one. And so maybe it was out of compassion. There's a practical reason that they offer it. Right? I guess more than that, it's a physical reason. Jesus is thirsty, and they're gracious, and they offer him a drink. The practical reason, really, would be that just a moment later, Jesus is now going to have his lips and his mouth wetted, right? So that he could, the Bible says he cried out the next phrase, right? It is finished. And so there's that practical reason that he had this drink. But more than that, I want to hone in this morning with you. There's a theological purpose to that simple little, and it's one word in the Greek, just like the word last week, it is finished is one word. I'm thirsty is just one word. But it has profound implications. So if you've got your notes, I want you to write this down. Number one is this. When Jesus said, I'm thirsty, it showed that he was truly a human. It showed that the Messiah was indeed a man. Now we know that Jesus was God incarnate, right? He was God in the flesh. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became what?
Flesh.
And made his dwelling among us. Now some people might say, well, Jesus was 50% God and 50% man, and that's unequivocally true. That's absolutely untrue. Jesus is 100% divine deity and 100% man. The Bible says, the Apostle Paul says, the fullness of the deity dwelt in bodily form. So to deny that Jesus is fully God and fully man is unscriptural. He was fully human so he could fully experience this life with us. So that he would know what it was like to walk in your shoes. To experience the pains and the heartaches and the sicknesses of life. Now at this time when John was writing, when he's writing his gospel, there is a sect or almost a cult of people called the Docetics. You ever heard of them? They're really similar to the Gnostics. But the Docetics taught that Jesus was God, but not really human. Now the human part of Jesus is more like an apparition, if you will, or maybe like a spirit or even a ghost, but it was an illusion. So you're just seeing this illusion. Remember after the resurrection, even Jesus on his body, he said, hey, I'm going to eat some fish to show that I'm not just a resurrected spirit. Well, guess what? Jesus had a real body from the very beginning of his conception. So John wanted his readers to understand this, and he wanted to know this. And John, from his perspective, John saying, look, I know the guy personally. I've eaten with him. I've slept with him. I've sat around a campfire with him. I've watched him. I've touched him. I've hugged him. I've known him. He was real, not an illusion. Now, we don't have Asceticism today as a group, but there is a thing called Islam. And did you know that the Quran teaches that God would never become a human being? That's antithetical to what the Bible teaches, isn't it?
Yes.
We just go to John 1:1, God became flesh. But the Quran teaches that God would never become a human being, nor would he die on a cross in such humiliation. Well, that's utterly antithetical to what we've already said this morning, right, church? That the cross is the centerpiece of everything that we are and everything that we do. But the Quran teaches that the disciples stole the body of Jesus away after he was arrested, and somebody else was put on the cross in his place. You don't get down off of the cross. Jesus died on the cross. Fully divine and fully man. Philippians chapter 2 says this, that Jesus made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. He's in human likeness, he looks like a human, and he died like a human. Right? Illusions, spirits don't die. Jesus died on the cross, Paul says. And so John wants to kind of beat that into our heads. He wants us to understand that. And there's this picture that he's drawing with pointing this out about Jesus and showing this humanity, this frailty that Jesus embodied himself with. And that's what I want to point out to you. That Jesus, you know, he is God in the flesh. But the flesh part reveals the frailty that he clothed himself in. He said, I thirst. One of John's greatest themes in the Gospel of John is his incarnation. That he came in the flesh. So illusions, ghosts don't say, I'm thirsty. They don't cry tears. They don't die. They don't weep. They don't bleed when their side is pierced, when their scalp is pierced, when their hands and feet are pierced. So it is just as wrong to deny the humanity of Jesus as it is wrong to deny the deity of Jesus. Because the scripture confirms both. Fully God and fully man. Number two. His thirst showed that he was really the promised Savior. His thirst was a fulfillment of Scripture. Look at verse 28 again. It says, so that the Scripture might be fulfilled. This is on the forefront of Jesus' mind the entire duration, church. He's thinking about fulfilling the will of His Father and the Word of God. He said, I'm thirsty. Now, we talked about this last week. There are some 380 prophecies about Messiah in the Old Testament. And for Jesus to fulfill every single one of them, like statistically, probability-wise, it is astronomical. Like our minds can't fathom it. But Jesus fulfilled every single one in every single way. It actually takes more faith, in my opinion, to believe that Jesus wasn't the Messiah than to believe that he was. Because of his perfect fulfillment of these prophetic utterances over the course of hundreds and hundreds of years before his birth. And here on the cross, just before he dies, Jesus fulfills yet another prophecy. Why? Why? Well, what does the text say? So the scriptures would be fulfilled. And in Psalm 69, verse 21, King David said, they put gall in my food and gave vinegar for my thirst. Now, how do you draw that out of the text? How do you draw that out of what David said? So I'm going to show you the gravity of what's going on here. Did you know that when David wrote this, this particular drink wasn't invented? Think about that just for a minute. David's writing about something. I mean, David's done that before. David's written about things that only the Holy Spirit inspiring him could put down things on paper because David didn't know about the things he was writing about. Just wasn't around. But this is a very common drink for Roman soldiers. Very common drink. The sour wine for Greeks, for Romans, around 300 BC up until this point in life. Commoners would carry it around with them. And so here's, when you think of this, what Jesus has offered on the cross. It's wine that had spoiled. So instead of... So think of it as vinegary tasting wine is what it is. It was very common for the Roman soldiers to carry this around, maybe in a canteen or some kind of pouch. They would have this and, you know, you get thirsty in the day. What do? You don't just go over to the local creek and get some water out because by and large that creek was filthy. A lot of wells you drew water out of tasted like sulfur. It was terrible. And so they would take this spoiled wine, dilute it with water, and you know, you could take herbs and other things, put in the water, and it was kind of tasty. It's kind of like, you know, you need a good drink, you're parched, you're thirsty, you know, there's something about grabbing, you know, an ice cold Gatorade or something like that. Just, you know, when you've lost a lot of salt in your body, or for some of you, maybe it's that ice cold Coca-Cola, you know, it just quenches your thirst a little bit better, right? Well, this quenched the thirst a little bit better. Now, more than that, that this spoiled wine, it killed bacteria. Chances are they didn't know anything about bacteria, right? But they knew that if you drink the water, you're going to get sick. You drink the water, you're going to go to the bathroom and stay in the bathroom. And so they're like, this kills the bacteria, makes the water better. Plus, it gave you vitamin C. Scurvy's not just for the pirates, right? We think of pirates, you know, avoiding scurvy. Well, they're avoiding scurvy too by getting the vitamin C. So this is very common for them to have this on hand, to offer Jesus this drink of sour wine. Now notice what they do next. And this is an interesting note too that I came across in my study, so I'll just share it with you. You know, Jesus obviously could not drink out of a cup while he was there hanging on the cross. But did you know that a lot of times the Roman soldiers carried a sponge with them and that's how they drank? And I was just kind of thinking about it. Maybe you could take a sponge, dip it in water, and you got a nice cold pack for your neck. But, you know, it was just an accessible thing without carrying a cup. But they take this sponge, they soak it in this vinegary wine, and they put it on, you notice what John points out, the branch of what? Hyssop. Yeah, branch of hyssop. Thousands of years before this event, before the cross, you might be thinking about the hyssop branch. What are you thinking of? Your mind is going back to the Exodus from Egypt. Passover night. There had been 9 plagues that God sent against the Egyptians and against Pharaoh for the hardening of his heart against the Israelite people. He refused to let them go, and they refused through each of the 9 plagues. And the 10th plague was going to be God was going to send the Spirit to kill all the firstborn children in Israel, right? But God told the Israelites, if you will put blood over the threshold and on the doorpost of your home, this angel of death will pass over, but you're supposed to brush the blood on with what? Now, with a hyssop branch. I'll spare your household. Exodus 12, 22, the Bible says, take a bunch of hyssop, dip it in the blood in the basin, and put some of the blood on the top and on both sides of the door frame. What a picture. John is just so great at pulling these things out and making these word pictures come alive. Because just as the blood of the Passover lamb caused the wrath of God to pass over, the blood of the Lamb of God covering your life causes the wrath of God to pass over. Amen. And what a Savior, church. Amen. He is the unblemished, perfect Passover Lamb of God, sacrificed for you. He really was the promised Savior. Number three, what we see in Jesus' thirst is this. It showed how much He really loves me. This is important because sometimes we feel like, does God love me? But this is just a small way to see it so clearly. Jesus thirsted for you and suffered for you so that you could go to heaven. The Bible says in Romans 5:8, God proves His own love for us in this. And while we're still dirty, rotten, no good, low down, scoundrel sinners, Christ died for us. We weren't looking for Him. We weren't trusting in Him. We weren't following Him. We weren't obeying Him. We don't deserve what He offered to us. While we were in that capacity, Christ died for us. While we were doing our own thing, thinking about our own agenda, planning our own calendar, you know, getting high, getting drunk, getting, you know, doing whatever we were doing, living carnal lives, lusting and lying and cheating, look, Christ died for us. I don't bring anything to the bargaining table. Because it's not a bargaining table. I don't bring anything to the table, period, because Christ brought everything Himself. So did you know the phrase, I thirst? Here's what's so cool to me. It was the life verse of this little bitty lady named Mother Teresa. Maybe you've heard of her before, but if you haven't, I'll tell you a little bit about her. It's her life verse. Mother Teresa said, our duty as Christians is to quench the thirst of Christ by quenching the thirst of those who are thirsty. Because, you know, Jesus isn't here. We can't quench His thirst. He's not here. And I can, hey, Jesus, you're thirsty. I got something to drink for you. But Jesus said, if you quench those who are thirsty, you're quenching my thirst. And that's what she did. She founded the Sisters of Charity. She founded the Mother Teresa's Home for the Dying. End-of-life stuff for some of the worst-case diseases there are. This is not just in Calcutta, India, but it's all around the world. These places continue to minister to the poorest of the poor, the sickest of the sick, to care for them on death's doorstep. It takes a really special person. Now, in every home for the dying, listen to this, where they took people in, took care of them, the poorest of the poor dying, the sickest of the sick, there was a picture of Jesus hanging in every single one of these houses for the dying. Did you know that? There's a picture of Jesus hanging on the cross, and you know what it says under the picture? I'm thirsty. I'm thirsty. A lot of people around you, church, are thirsty. Now, your neighbor's not going to come to you and say, hey, I'm spiritually thirsty and I need to talk to you a little bit. It's probably not going to happen. It might. But people are physically thirsty, but more than that, they're emotionally thirsty, they're spiritually thirsty. The people you work with are thirsty. Your next door neighbor, your aunt, your uncle, maybe your parents, they're spiritually thirsty. They might not say, look, I'm spiritually thirsty, but you're going to hear the cues that they're thirsty because they're going to say things like this. I just don't know the purpose of it all. I'm bored. I just don't feel like my life is very fulfilling. I don't really see the point in all this. My life feels empty. There's got to be more to this life. I'm stressed out. I'm at the end of my rope. I don't see any light at the end of the tunnel. I've got no hope. And if those aren't clues that people are spiritually thirsty, that they're spiritually dehydrated, I don't know what it is, because these statements are statements of real thirst that people have in your life. So what are we going to do about it? What are we supposed to do about it? The Bible talks about spiritual thirst, being spiritually dehydrated. Because they're spiritually thirsty for meaning. They're thirsty for purpose. They're thirsty for hope. They're thirsty for significance in life. There's got to be more to this life. You know, asking all the big questions. People want to know, why am I here? Where am I going when it's over? And the little dash between those numbers, what am I here? What am I supposed to be doing while I'm here? What's my purpose? And people want to know these things. And look, I believe that people are looking for a word from God, but they're looking in all the wrong places. People are searching. People are hungry. They're thirsty. They're looking. Long ago, the prophet Amos wrote these words. Look at this. The minor prophet Amos wrote in chapter 8. The days are coming, declares the sovereign Lord, when I shall send a famine through the land. Not a famine of food, not a famine of thirst for water, but a famine of hearing the words of the Lord. Men will stagger from sea to sea. They will wander from north to west, or north to east, searching for the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. In that day, the lovely young women and the strong young men, they will faint because of thirst. People are spiritually thirsty. How much does that sound like our world today? How much does that sound like, maybe not your life right now, maybe it does, but maybe you can say that was a picture of my life before I found Jesus, right? I was searching, I was looking, I knew that I was thirsty, I knew that I was hungry, but I couldn't find satisfaction in anything, anywhere. You know, people look so good on the outside, don't they? You can have it all together. But on the inside, there's emptiness, there's depression, there's discouragement, there's despair. Because they're thirsty. And they're looking for something. So that's Jesus' thirst. Number two, and overall, I want to look at these three things with you. We're going to look at people's thirst, because people are thirsty. Number one is this. How can we quench their thirst? We can serve Jesus by serving others. Church, I want you to know that when you are meeting the thirst in people's lives, you are meeting the thirst of Christ in that way. The way you serve God is by serving people. Jesus made it clear. Matthew chapter 25. The Bible says, the righteous will answer him. This is on the day of judgment. Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? We didn't see you. You weren't there with us. When did we see you thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? And the king will reply, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. We quench Jesus' thirst by quenching the thirst of others. You think about Jesus on the cross, he could have quenched his own thirst, couldn't he? I mean, he'd been doing miracles all along the way. He could have quenched his own thirst, right? Now he's the one that created H2O, isn't he?
Yes.
He could have just wet my tongue. It could have been wet. But he asked for someone's assistance. You know, when you have a need in your life, I would encourage you, pray about it. Something comes up and you don't know what to do, pray about it. Seek the Lord and pray. But sometimes I'm going to tell you, church, the answer from God is going to be this: do something about it. Sometimes God's going to say, okay, you need to move then. You need to get up and move. You need to do something. crying out to me, but I've given you two legs and two arms and five fingers, five toes, and you know, I've given a mind and your brain. You need to go do something. 10 fingers, 10 toes, right?
Yeah.
And I was seeing if you were paying attention. Only one of you was. God says, do something about it. Suffering is always an opportunity to do something. You can show the love of Christ you can infuse it into situations when there is suffering. You can be hope and you can be encouragement, you can be love. So will you do something? My question for you. Will you do something? Will you serve someone? Will you genuinely love them and care about their need? Number two, God notices the smallest service. Did you know that? God sees the smallest thing. Now, I know a lot of us, we've said in our life, we want to do something great for the Lord, right? I've prayed it before. God, I want to do something big. I want to do something great for you. You ever prayed that prayer? Something extravagant, something grand. I want to make an impact, create a ripple, start a tidal wave. Lord, you know, do something big for you. And God says, listen, why don't you start somewhere small? Because if I can trust you to do something small, then I can trust you to do something a little bigger. But just start somewhere small, because needs are around you every single day. Do you know that? They're around you every single day. It's not the size of your service that matters. Listen, church, it's the amount of love and grace you put into that service. Sometimes we need to remind ourselves. I know the church, some of you, you know, you've served and you've served and you've served, and some things get mundane, some things get rote, and some things get even a little bit discouraging because you say nobody notices, nobody cares, or somebody got upset with somebody over something along the way. And I'm talking to you folks who have been in church for a while. You know, you're going to butt heads, or somebody's going to say something, you're going to get offended. Listen, are you pouring love and grace into your service because you're serving the King? You're serving the King, and that's what matters. And you pour love and pour grace into that situation and into those people, and you love those people. Most of us don't know who... think about just... I'm just using around here for context. You don't know who fills the communion cups. You don't know who mows the grass. Those are simple little things. And some of us don't even know who maybe teaches the kids. Who gives to the food pantry? Where'd all those bags just show up in the kitchen magically? It's a miracle. You know? Paying the bills, whatever. These are often overlooked and thankless jobs, aren't they? You don't see them. But I tell you what. I have brothers and sisters who get great satisfaction out of the smallest things because I know that they're doing it out of their love for Christ. Because what Christ sees matters the most. So small things, helping an elderly neighbor with a chore, giving to somebody in need, being kind to a child. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, verse 42, He says, if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones because he's my disciple, I tell you the truth, he will certainly not lose his reward. I came across a pretty incredible story by a Christian living in India named Doug Nichols. I want to just share this story with you real quick. So just bear with me as I share this. So Doug Nichols writes, he says, when I got tuberculosis in India, I was forced to stay in a sanitarium for several months. I didn't speak the language. That'd be tough, right? But I was there to serve Christ, and so I was giving out Christian tracts, and I was giving out literature on Jesus to several of the patients and the doctors and the staff. And every time I gave one away, they would just politely refuse. Nobody took a single piece of literature that I was trying to give. Now, the first few nights, I woke up around 2 a.m. coughing. And during one of my coughing spells, Nichols said, he said, I noticed an older man who was even sicker with tuberculosis, a patient who was across the room in a bed. He said the old man would sit up on the edge of his bed, but when he tried to stand in weakness, he'd fall back in his bed. So he'd just try to get up and he'd fall back in his bed. No matter how much he tried, he would fall back. He finally gave up, exhausted. He said, I tried to close my eyes and go back to sleep, but all I could hear was him over there softly weeping. Now the next morning I realized what the man had been trying to do, been trying to get up to go to the bathroom. He said the stench in our ward was almost unbearable. He said other patients, they were yelling at the man for making a mess. He said angry nurses were roughly moving him around the bed and changing his clothes. He said one nurse even got in the old man's face and slapped him. Was so angry at him for messing himself. And the old man, after they were done changing him, rolled over. He crawled up into a ball and he continued to weep. He said, the next night I woke up again, I was coughing, and I noticed the same man was trying to get out of bed again. And like the night before, he would try to push himself up so weakly and just fall back into the bed, and try to push himself up again and fall back. So, Nichols did something. He says, I got up out of my bed and I went over to help him. He said, when I leaned over top of the bed and I looked down at him, he said, the man's eyes got real wide and he kind of moved back away from me in fear. He said, but I didn't say a word. I couldn't say a word, but instead I reached my arms down under his arms, under his armpits, and pulled him up to sit up straight. And then I led him down the corridor to the bathroom, which was absolutely filthy. He said it was smelled terrible. It was just a hole in the ground in the bathroom. And he said, and I bent over with this old man as he squatted over this hole. And he finished his business. I helped him up, helped him clean up, and helped him back to his bed. And I laid him down. He said, and the man reached up and he kissed me on the cheek. And he smiled at me and said something in Indian that I couldn't understand. He said, the next morning I was awakened by another patient who came over to me with a hot, steaming cup of tea. And he requested one of the tracts about Jesus that I had been carrying. And as the sun rose, other patients approached, and he said they indicated they also wanted the booklets. And he said it seemed like everyone was now interested. Throughout the day, nurses and interns and doctors, all of the staff were even asking for this literature. He says, weeks later, one of the local Christian ministers who spoke the language visited me, and he told me that several of the people from that sanitarium had put their trust and their faith in Christ. He said, look, I didn't give an eloquent speech. Heck, I didn't even know the language. He said, I didn't sit him down and have a debate with him on why Jesus was better than Hinduism. He said, I didn't speak anything persuasive, right? I just helped an old man to the bathroom. I thought, wow. Is anybody going to be in heaven because of you? What level of love are you willing to show? I want to be like Mr. Nichols. That's impressive, isn't it? That's some action oozing with grace, isn't it? That's love for a brother, a neighbor. Here's what I want to show you. Number three. The most Christ-like love you can show, did you know, is to your enemies? Like, I was hoping the preacher wouldn't bring up this one. And I want to tell you what the Bible says in Proverbs 25. If your enemy is hungry, give him food to eat. If he is thirsty, give him water to drink. But Lord, I don't like their lifestyle. Lord, what they do makes me sick. I can't stand it. I can't even stand to look at them because I know what they're doing. Right? I don't agree. Here, I'm going to watch it. I don't agree with their political views. Why would I help them out? Whatever. I don't like the fact that they don't like me. They hate my guts, whatever it is. Jesus said, if you want to be my follower, you give them something to drink. Let me wrap this up. I want to talk personally to you. Are you thirsty? Are you thirsty? I want you to realize, church, what you're really thirsty for. I think we're all thirsty. Some of us have had our thirst quenched. Others have gotten thirsty again, and some of us need to be quenched for the first time, I believe. And what are you thirsty for? You might think, look, if I could just get married, if I could just have kids, I'll have all my needs met. That's what I want, right? If I could make a little bit more money, then I'll be happy. Once I graduate, once I get that job that I've been looking for, once I get a girlfriend or a boyfriend or a husband or a wife, or I get the bonus once I go on that vacation, once I get that new car or that new house, or I get that next fix. Listen, church, nothing is going to fill that God-shaped hole in your life like the Lord Jesus, because He's the only one who can fill it. Listen, not sex, salary, status, success, none of it's going to fill and fulfill your heart. Because we've all looked for it before, haven't we? To fill us up and to make us happy. No person is going to fill the void that only Jesus can fill. Your husband is not going to fill it. Your wife is not going to fill it. Your boss is not going to fill it. As long as you're looking to other things to fill this void, you're going to be unsatisfied. You're going to be worshiping idols. You're going to be, as the psalm says, looking for love in all the wrong places, right? Anything that takes God's place is an idol. Here's your truth. Listen to this. Psalm 63:1. David knew what we needed. Oh God, You are my God. He said, earnestly, I seek You. My soul, it thirsts for You. My body, it longs for You. In a dry and weary land where there is no water. God, only You quench my thirst. That's why Jesus said, look, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. They're the ones that are going to be really filled up. Only God can satisfy. Here's the number two, and some of you need to hear this. God knows your pain. Look, Jesus knows your pain. That's part of what Jesus is saying when He says, I thirst. He's saying, look, I identify with every single human being who's ever been born on planet Earth. He can identify with you. I thirst. He understands what you're going through. Listen, the Bible says, for we do not have a high priest, we don't have a Savior, Messiah, who's unable to sympathize with us in our weaknesses. He is able, church. We have Jesus, who's been tempted in every way just as we are, yet was without sin. Now listen, maybe you're dealing with physical pain. Your back's out again. Right? Arthritis sets in. Somebody give me an amen. The older we get, the more aches and pains we get, don't we?
Oh, yes.
Right. It's a part of life. Could be a debilitating disease. Maybe you're dealing with constant migraines. I don't know what it is. But listen to me, church. I want to say this. Jesus understands your physical pain. He understands it. Maybe you've been abused. Maybe you've been rejected. Those are horrible things. Maybe you've been mocked. Maybe you've been bullied. Maybe you're lonely. Maybe you're experiencing depression. Anxiety. It's got you on pins and needles. Listen, maybe you've lost a loved one. Jesus knows. And He cares. But listen to me, church. Jesus understands your emotional pain too. He's been there. Jesus was bearing the weight of sin in His body on the cross. Listen, not His own sin, but your sin. That's what He carried. The Bible says the cup of the wrath of God was being poured out on Him. So I want you to keep picturing this picture that John's drawing when you think of this cup. Even though it's a sponge, but think of the cup. The idea that's happening here. The wrath of God being poured out on Christ on the cross. The wrath that you and I deserved. He's taking. So listen to me, church. Jesus understands your spiritual pain too, because He's felt it. on the cross. Jesus knows what you're going through. So here's the last thing I want to say to you. Stop looking for satisfaction anywhere else. I can tell you from the biblical truth, you're not going to find it. I can tell you from experience, you're not going to find it. Quit looking elsewhere. I mean, we're always looking to find something to fulfill our lives, aren't we? To make us happy. To give us satisfaction. To give us significance. You know, if I had this house, I'd be happy. If I had these clothes, I'd be cool. Whatever it is. If I could get my hair done, I'd be happier, right? Whatever it is. If I could get plastic surgery, I'd look younger again. If I could get that dream job, then I'm really going to be satisfied with life. Everything will be good. But listen to what God says in Jeremiah 2:13. I don't want you to miss this verse. We're almost done. Listen to what God says. My people have committed two sins. And I feel like I read this verse and I thought, is God talking to the ancient Israelites? Or is He talking to 21st century American Christians? And of course it dawned on me both. But listen to what He says. My people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me. Number one, they've turned their back on me. The spring of living water now. They've turned their back on me. And they have dug their own cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. Isn't that everything that we've been saying so far? You dig a well called my job. You dig a well called even my family. You dig a well called my house. You dig a well called my career. You dig a well called my hobbies. And guess what? If I put all my hope in that well, guess what? That well's going to have cracks. It's going to leak. It's not going to hold water. And I'm going to, if I put my hope in those things and my search for significance in those things, every single time I'm going to wind up thirsty again and again and again. And all the while, we're digging our cistern. Digging our cistern, right? Digging our cistern. Guess what? Niagara Falls is right behind me. And I'm like, I got this thimble. It makes me so happy. And God's ready to unleash a torrent of spiritual blessings in Christ on my life. And I'm satisfied with the thimble. A filthy water. Puts it in perspective, doesn't it? Jesus said in John 7, if anyone is thirsty, who's that leave out? Nobody. Nobody is left out. Because anyone who is thirsty can come and Jesus will give him a drink. Jesus said, I don't care what, I'll share my cup. As a matter of fact, I want to share my cup. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of living water welling up to eternal life. You know, spring water is always fresh, right? It's always clean and drinkable. It's almost always cool and refreshing. And Jesus says, listen, take my cup and spring water and it's always bubbling over and you can keep drinking and drinking and drinking and you'll be satisfied forever. In John chapter 4, Jesus says, whoever drinks the water I give him, listen, will, somebody tell me, never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. This is sustaining not just for this life, but this is sustaining for all eternity because from the throne of God in heaven flows the mighty river of God.
That's right.
Right? We'll never thirst again. If you keep trying to dig your own wells, you're going to keep getting cracks in them and you're going to keep being thirsty again and again. Listen, anytime you put something in God's place, you're going to be thirsty. That's what sin does. It promises, hey, this will taste good, this will quench it, and it never does. It's like drinking a cup of salt water. You become more dehydrated and even thirstier. You know, if you don't believe it, ask anybody who's trying to find fulfillment, who's trying to, you know, who's looking at pornography. Is it satisfying? No. Is it fulfilling? No. It keeps you. You got to keep going back. Once is not enough. Ask somebody who's tried it with a prescription bottle. Once is never enough. You got to keep going back to it. Anger, envy, greed, lust, whatever, once is not enough, because sin makes you thirstier and thirstier, doesn't it? And maybe you're dehydrated. Jesus says, come. Here's my cup of living water. Drink it. It's yours. And it becomes spring in you, welling up to eternal life. Jesus is the only one who will permanently satisfy you, beloved. He is the only one who will meet every need in every way, in every area of your life. So it keeps me coming back. Because I know I need Him. If you're thirsty for Jesus this morning, make Him your Lord and Savior today. Church, I want to remind you, keep coming back to the well that never runs dry. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Father, You were thirsty so that we wouldn't have to be. Sure, we're thirsty in this life, physically. But God, we know that our spiritual thirst can be quenched in every way, shape, and form. Father, thank You for that fountain that flows so rich with grace and mercy. Father, may we keep coming back again and again to drink from the well in which we'll never thirst again. Father, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together and worship this morning, church. And as you praise, just let Him know how thankful you are and how grateful you are that He's given you this water to quench this thirst in your life. Let's worship Him today. great to be with you in worship today. Amen. And great to have you with us online today and worship our King, the one who gives us living water as well. So God bless you and be with you. I'm going to have a word of prayer and then give some instructions after that if you just remain hanging out. So according to our bylaws, we got a formality here of affirming what our elders are putting forth as a church and the direction that we want to go. And that is that we would like to ask you to affirm with us that Mr. Dan Conway would become our next staff member here at Southwest. And we believe that Dan is the man that God is leading for this job, and we're excited. So I'm going to have a word of prayer. And according to our bylaws, those who are our members of the church here will make that vote. Feel free, if you're not, stick around and celebrate with us. And we'll celebrate with you, and we'll celebrate together. And otherwise, you can go. So I'm going to have a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your grace and your mercy, Lord. Thank you for this time of worship. And Lord, as we seek to be your church in the world, give us a vision for those desire to serve those who are the least of these, who are truly spiritually thirsty. And we would go to them and we would say, look, we know where you can get this water that you'll never thirst again. And it's the most refreshing, the sweetest tasting, the most satisfying. Because, Father, we know the Lord Jesus is everything that we need. And His grace is enough. And His salvation is sufficient. So thank you for that. And we are here to worship you, Lord, for that great gift today. And Father, give us a vision for those who are in need, but a vision for those who are spiritually thirsty and who are lost without you. That we would follow in the footsteps of our Master who came to seek and save the lost. Father, thank you that you showed us how much you loved us, that while we were still sinners, you sent your one and only Son to die for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.